بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We continue with our reading from منهاج العابدين, The Path of the Worshippers. Imam al-Ghazali said, and he's attempting to reconcile what the to put together to come up with a thesis of what all the ulama said about taqwa, and to reconcile all what they have said with the hadith that has been mentioned by the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم about taqwa. He said, فأقول, after he says, فأحببت أن أجمع ما بين ما قاله علماؤنا رحمه الله تعالى وبينما جاء في الخبر عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فيكون حدا جامعا ومعنا بالغا. Yes. I want to compliment what the scholars said about taqwa with what is said in the tradition of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in order to present a comprehensive definition of the term meaning taqwa. فأقول التقوى هو اجتناب كل ما تخاف منه ضررا في دينك. ألا ترى أنه يقال المريض المحتمي إنه متق إذا اجتنب كل شيء يضره في بدنه من طعام أو شراب أو فاكهة أو غيرها. So I said that taqwa is avoiding anything which you fear may harm your religion. Have you not heard about or that a sick man is told to abstain from consuming food, drink, and other similar things that are harmful to his body. So he would be described as muttaqi if he fulfills all that, if he abstains. Things that could harm your religion are of two kinds. ثم الذي يخاف منه ضرر في أمر الدين قسمان. محض الحرام ومحض المعصية. محض الحرام والمعصية. One is sin and is merely forbidden by law. The other excessive indulgence in that which is permitted by law. ثم الذي يخاف من الضرر في أمر الدين قسمان محض الحرام والمعصية وفضول الحلال. لأن الاشتغال بفضول الحلال والانهماك فيه يستجر صاحب الحرام ومحض العصيان وذلك لشره النفس وطغيانها وتمرد الهوى وعصيانه. So things that could harm your religion are of two kinds. One is sin and is merely forbidden by law, haram. The other excessive indulgence. In fact, it's excessive indulgence in that which is permitted by law, halal. Second one is about that which is halal. And definitely there is indulgence. But the problem here, I think Imam Ghazali is saying something else. Not that which is excessive, it is that which is extra. It is that which is not essential. Because one could be dragged to the haram through this particular window, if you will. For it will gradually lead to sin and rebellion. يستجر صاحبه الحرام ومحض العصيان. الحلال, of course it is excessive anyhow. But it's, one should be wary of that which is halal and it's not essential. Because being used to it, it becomes difficult for the nafs to give up on its indulgence, its addiction, even if it's halal. You know, one might say, what kind of addiction is halal? Chocolate. I'm just giving an example. And I know it from people around me, literally. Yes. For it will gradually lead to sin and rebellion. This is due to the overpowering and greedy nature of the carnal soul, and due to the rebellious nature of one's passion. Therefore, he who seeks to safeguard his religion shall avoid danger and abstain from indulgence in that which is allowed as a precautionary measure against falling into the trap of outright sin. فمن أراد أن يعمل الضرر في أمر دينه يجتنب الخطر فامتنع عن فضول الحلال وحذر من يجر إلى محض الحرام. Hence the saying of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, لتركهم ما لا بأس به حذرا مما به بأس. يعني لتركهم فضول الحلال حذرا عن وقوعه في الحرام. Therefore, the Prophet ﷺ said, God-fearing and pious people abstain from that which is lawful and permitted as a precautionary measure against that which is declared haram by the Sharia. And this issue has been, of course, it has several traditions. The original hadith, it is from, it was narrated by Atiyya al-Sa'di. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him. And the text of the hadith is a bit different from what Imam al-Razali mentioned. It says لا يبلغ العبد أن يكون المتقين حتى يدع ما لا بأس به حذرا مما حذرا لما به بأس. So you don't reach that stage. The عبد, the servant, of course it goes both ways, male and female, they don't reach this degree of to be included in the category of المتقين until they let go of that which is okay for fear مما لا بأس به, it is halal, for fear of that which is really problematic, for fear of that which is haram. So it could be something that is really absolutely mubah, something permissible. Yes. And we know that there are other traditions about the same hadith really. It has been said also that Umar ibn Khattab, as a commentary here, I'm trying to expand a little bit on the this notion. So it has been narrated that Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab said, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him, كنا نترك 70 بابا من حلال خشية النقع في باب واحد. We used to leave 70 doors, meaning 70 areas of halal, for fear of falling into one which is haram. And this is taqwa. Yes. And the same thing was narrated practically about Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Yeah. In terms of the area of transactions, monetary transactions, business, Again, Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab said that we have left 9/10 of halal transactions for fear of usury, interest, riba. I think this is really, it's practically almost the other way around today. People are willing to go into riba directly, unfortunately. Yes. فالتقوى البالغة الجامعة اجتناب كل ما فيه ضرر لأمر الدين والمعصية والفضول هذا تفصيلها. After the hadith was mentioned, Imam Ghazali رحمه الله said, therefore, perfect and comprehensive piety and fear of God is to abstain from anything in which there is harm to the affairs of religion. This includes sin and indulgence in that which is lawful. This is a brief description of piety and fear of God. However, if we want to define it within the confines of the science of Sharia, we should say that in the context of the Sharia, piety and fear of God denotes exerting your will to purify the heart of evils and sins, the likes of which have not been committed by you before, until this practice becomes a means of protection for you from all sins and evil deeds. This is the exact definition of it. وأما إدارة التحديد على موضوع علم الشرع فنقول حد التقوى الجامع تنزيه القلب عن شر لم يسبق عنك مثله بقوة العزم على تركه حتى سداك وقاية بينك وبين كل شر لم يسبق عنك مثله. The likes of which have not been committed by you before. Then evil, ثم الشرور, evil deeds, evil notions, evil ideas, evil thoughts. ثم الشرور الضربان, شر أصلي وهو منهي عنه كالمعاصي المحضة, والشر غير أصلي وهو منهي عنه تأديبا, وهو فضول الحلال كالمباحات المأخوذة بالشهوات. Then you must know that evil deeds and sins are of two kinds. One is the cardinal group and includes all sins and acts that are forbidden. Cardinal, original, formative. The other kind is a minor group of deeds and includes all that must be avoided by way of disciplining one's soul. فالأولى تقوى فرض يلزم بتركها عذاب النار, والثانية تقوى خير وأدب يلزم بتركها الحبس والحساب والتعيير واللوم. فمن أتى بالأولى فهو في درجة الدنيا من التقوى وهي منزلة مستقيمي الطاعة, ومن أتى بالأخرى فهو في الدرجة العليا من التقوى وذلك منزلة مستقيمي ترك المباح. The first is obligatory and must be avoided or else it will lead you to the fire of hell. There will be a punishment. It will lead to punishment. In fire, in hellfire, of course. Abstaining from the second kind is a virtue, and excessive indulgence in them may result in shame and reckoning in the hereafter. He who observes the first group avoids cardinal sins is in the lower station of taqwa than those who preserve in abstaining from that which is lawful. A servant of God who combines both and observes them, that is to say, avoids that which is forbidden as well as that which is discouraged, reaches the station of perfect taqwa. This is perfect asceticism, wara, and the perfect criterion in the affairs of religion. It is the station of etiquette and proper manner, adab, before the divine gate. The true meaning of taqwa and its full description. May God help us succeed in attaining this station, if He wills. فإذا جمع العبد بينهما يعني اجتناب كل معصية وفضول فقد استكمل معنى التقوى وقام بحقها وجمع كل خير فيها وهذا هو الورع الكامل الذي هو ملاك أمر الدين وذلك منزلة الأدب على باب الله تعالى فهذا معنى التقوى بينه في الجملة فافهمه موفقا إن شاء الله تعالى. The notion of adab, the notion of adab, منزلة الأدب على باب الله تعالى. Today it's compared to early Islamic history. They used to send children to the mu'addib. We talk about the root of it, of course, is adab. Partakes in the notion of adab. So they used to send kids to the mu'addib. Or even if they say to the mu'allim, they would still learn both ilm and adab at the same time. So you talk about reforming or forming the person, the personality, the psyche. And today, the ministries of education in the Arab world, and probably all of them would include the word tarbiyah one way or the other. So Wizarat al-Tarbiyah or Ta'lim, for example. Ta'lim is education, teaching. How about tarbiyah? It's a very problematic concept, though I know that they don't mean it this way, but I'm talking about the language. Tarbiyah is raising, even when you talk about raising animals, that is still tarbiyah. And they do say in Arabic, tarbiyah al-mawashi. And a tarbiyah is always something measurable one way or the other. This is why Fir'aun, when he, the Pharaoh, when he spoke with Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, he reminded him that he provided for him, and he used the word "alam nurabbika tarbiya," "alam nurabbika fina walida." For Fir'aun is cannot and does not, of course, does not have the adab that he, you know, that will be necessary to impart to Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, because he was raised in the house of the Pharaoh. And there's the hadith, though the chain of narrator might have just a little bit of a problem, nevertheless the meaning is so beautiful, adabani rabbi fa ahsan ta'dibi. So we used to talk about adab. Adab is the right behavior at the right time, at the right space. فإن قلت ففصل لنا الآن هذا المعنى في النفس واستعماله فيها، فإن الحاجة جاءت من هنالك لنعلم كيف نلجم هذه النفس بهذا المعنى الذي فصلت من حقيقة التقوى. If it is said describe these concepts in a differentiated manner. Tell us how to apply them to our soul and how to put them into practice in our life so that we can learn to control our carnal soul and that has become distance from taqwa. I say, أقول فأقول أجل إنما تفصيل في أمر هذه النفس أن تقوم عليها بقوة العزم فتمنعها عن كل معصية وتصونها عن كل فضول. I say that it is its explanation is that in the affairs of the soul rise against it with the power of your will and determination, prevent it from committing all kinds of sins and safeguard it from indulging in that which is discouraged. فأقول أجل إنما تفصيله في أمر هذه النفس أن تقوم عليه بقوة العزم فتمنعها عن كل معصية وتصونها عن كل فضول. When you do this, you exercise piety and you will become God-fearing and pious. In what your eyes see, what your ears hear, what your hands do, what your tongue says, and what your heart feels. فإن فعلت ذلك كنت قد اتقيت الله تعالى في عينك وأذنك ولسانك وقلبك وبطنك وفرجك وجميع أعضائك وألجمتها بلجام التقوى. ألجمتها بلجام التقوى. ولهذا الباب شرح يطول وقد أشرنا إليه في كتاب إحياء علوم الدين. When you do this, you exercise piety and you become God-fearing and pious in what your eyes see and what your ears hear and what your hands do in fact the order is what your tongue says and what your heart basically feels, what your heart basically entertains. So you have piety. Then he says, وَبَطْنِكَ وَفَرْجِكَ. You control your inner organs and all other parts of your body, even your genitals, with the reins of taqwa. Yes. But also, because really it's about two lusts, the sexuality and food. Both of them are mentioned here in Arabic in clear terms. وبطنك وفرجك وجميع أعضائك and all your organs and you will basically control them, you put them on a leash وألجمتها بلجام التقوى. ولهذا الباب شرح يزول قد أشرنا إليه في كتاب إحياء علوم الدين. Further description of this will be too long to present here and we have alluded alluded to it in our book, The Reverification of the Sciences of Religion. We have alluded, yes, basically he does mention all this in Ihya Ulumuddin. For example, when Imam Ghazali speaks about the three phases, three levels of fasting, where one goes beyond abstinence, abstaining from food, drink, and intimate relationship between spouses. The next level is the abstinence fasting of all the organs. And even out of politeness, Imam Ghazali says that all of you. But of course, what he means here is avoiding that which is haram in the area of sexuality. That's the context for that. In the Ihya Ulumuddin, in the revivification, the revival of the Islamic sciences. Here, what I have to say is that he who wishes to be pious before God must protect the five organs in his body, as they are the foundation of all behavior. وأما الذي لا بد منه هنا فأن نقول من أراد يتق الله تعالى فليراعي الأعضاء الخمسة فإنها الأصول. The big five, if you will, is basically the eye, the ear, the tongue, the heart, and the tummy, the stomach, meaning the idea is that organ that deals with food. Yes. So these five organs, who are the foundation of all behavior, they are your eyes, your ears, your tongue, your heart, and your stomach. Protect them from all that you fear. For all that you fear will harm your religion, such as sins and lawful acts and indulgence in lawful acts. Once you succeed in controlling and protecting these organs, there is hope that all your body will submit itself to God Most High. So after mentioning العين والأذن واللسان والقلب والبطن فيحرص عليها بالصيانة لها عن كل ما يخاف منه ضررا في أمر الدين من معصية وحرام وفضول وإسراف بالحلال. فإذا حصل صيانة هذه الأعضاء فمرجو أن يكفى سائر أركانه ويكون قام بالتقوى الجامعة بجميع بدنه لله عز وجل. فدعت الحاجة إلى بيان خمسة فصول لهذه الأعضاء وتفصيل ما يحرم يحق كل واحد منها على قدر ما يليق بهذا الكتاب. So Imam Ghazali says that it's after he mentions all those organs, the five organs, he says once you succeed in controlling and protecting these organs, there is hope that all your body will submit itself to God Most High. Therefore, it is necessary to devote five sections to these organs and explain that which is forbidden in regard to each of them, one by one, as much as the space of this book permits. The space, it could be a matter of space, but here I think the ma yaliq basically that which is appropriate for this book, that which is appropriate. And then he starts with the eyes. And ثم عليك وفق الله وإيانا بحفظ العين فإنها سبب كل فتنة وآفة وأذكر في أمرها ثلاثة أصول كافية. The eyes, it is your duty to control your eye. For that is the source of all temptations and troubles. May God grant you and us His help and success. I will mention three principles that must be remembered regarding the eyes. The first, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ ذَلِكَ أَزْكَى لَهُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا يَصْنَعُونَ. Say to the believers, that they cast down their eyes, lower their gaze, that's what it is, and guard their private parts, that is purer for them. God is aware of their deeds. Know that when I contemplated this verse, and this is Imam Ghazali speaking, وَعَلَمْ أَنِّي تَعْمَلْتُ هَذِي الْآيَةِ فَوْجَدْتُ فِيهَا مَعَ قِصَرِهَا ثَلَاثَ مَعَانٍ عَزِيزَةً تَأْدِيبٌ وَتَنْبِيهٌ وَتَهْدِيدٌ. So know that when I contemplated this verse, I realized that despite its shortness, three powerful meanings are combined in this verse. They pertain to disciplining, warning and threatening and punishing the eyes. Well, the ta'dib, the first one, in regard to disciplining, God commands, say to the believers, that they cast down their eyes. يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ. The servant must obey the command of his master and emulate his manners. Otherwise, he would be an ill-mannered and rude servant and would not be allowed to attend the sanctuary, chapter of his master, and his presence. You must try to understand this subtle point and contemplate it, or contemplate its underlining meaning. وأن فهم التأديب فقوله تعالى قل إني أغض من أبصارهم ولا بد العبد من ثاني أمر السيد والتأدب به وإلا فيكون سيء الأدب فيحجب فلا يؤذن له في حضور المجلس والمثول بالحضرة. فافهم هذه النقطة وتأمل ما تحتها فإن فيها ما فيها. Yes. The servant must obey. So the verse itself in regard to discipline, God commands, say to the believers that they cast down their eyes to lower their gaze. The servant must obey the command of his master and emulate his manners. Otherwise, he would be an ill-mannered and rude servant and would not be allowed to attend the sanctuary chamber of his master, and his presence. You must try to understand this subtle point and contemplate its underlining meaning. وأما التنبيه فقوله تعالى ذلك أزكى لهم وينطلق على معنيين والله أعلم. Regarding warning, it is denoted by God saying, this is purer azka for them, which indicates two meanings. God knows best. One meaning is that purification of the heart, zakah, illuminates it. Zakah means cleansing. I think this is very important. And tazkiyah means purification. So it's a very important notion of zakah, purification. But it's really as a part of adab. It can also mean that zakah causes the growth of their good deed and more. For the term originally also means increase in blessings. Therefore, God says that keeping the eyes from seeing that which is forbidden. Therefore, God says that keeping the eyes from seeing that which is forbidden results in purity of heart and increase in worship and virtue. So if you do not protect your eyes from seeing that which they should not see, and let the reins loose, two possibilities will occur. If you look, and not really a sudden look, it's not that fraction of a second, at that which does not concern you, you are likely to encounter that which is forbidden. And in case you deliberately gaze at it, you will have committed a capital sin. It is possible that your heart will get attached to it. As a result, you will be destroyed if God does not have mercy on you. I think it's enough for today. Inshallah, we will continue with these. In fact, with the eye, because we are not done with that. But there are essential notions here that could be applicable to every single one of them. We talk about the ear, but we still have 2-3 pages, and then the tongue. Yes. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد ان لا اله الا انت نستغفرك ونتوب اليك السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته